É o programa que mágicos do mundo inteiro não querem que você veja. Mr. M está de volta mais uma vez, ameaçando expor os segredos mais bem guardados do mundo. Você irá descobrir como são feitas aparições incríveis, fugas audaciosas, levitações impressionantes, desaparecimentos inexplicáveis, truques fascinantes e ilusões impossíveis. Nenhum mágico é famoso demais. Nenhum truque é grande demais. Nenhum segredo é sagrado demais. Os segredos dos mágicos sempre serão revelados pelo grande Mr. M. Desvendando os segredos dos mágicos, Mr. M.
Para começar, Mr. M irá enfrentar a afiada lâmina de aço dessa serra circular industrial. Como ele está prestes a descobrir, a serra é real e os dentes são incrivelmente afiados. Oh, cuidado com os dedos. Mr. M liga a serra. Faz com que ela suba até o alto da torre. Lembra do ditado, tudo que sobe, desce? Então, por segurança, a serra para antes de as garotas passarem por baixo. As assistentes posicionam uma caixa semelhante a um caixão embaixo da serra. Tomara que não acabe se tornando um caixão de verdade. A tampa é aberta e ele entra tentando encontrar uma posição confortável nesta situação extremamente desconfortável. É um bom momento para lembrar que isso não deve ser recriado. Mr. M pode estar revelando os segredos, mas ele é um profissional treinado. A caixa é aberta e é possível ver que Mr. M está preso por faixas de aço na cintura e algemas. Ele não vai a lugar nenhum. Quando a serra começa a descer, Mr. M tem apenas 30 segundos para escapar. Primeiro, ele precisa lutar contra as algemas. Não deve ser difícil. Faltam apenas 20 segundos. Isso não parece bom. As assistentes receberam a ordem de não parar a serra. Mas elas irão obedecer? A serra está a centímetros de distância. Ele vai fugir a tempo? Parece que não. Isso foi inesperado. E nós ainda temos uma hora de segredos para revelar. Que pena que ele não deixou esse truque por último. Poderia ter matado dois coelhos com uma cajadada só. Ou uma serra gigante. Parece que é o fim de Mr. M. Mas seria bom ter uma prova de que ele realmente foi cortado. Então, as assistentes separam a caixa. E adeus, Mr. M. Foi bom conhecê-lo. O perigo neste número é tão real quanto esperado, graças a essa autêntica e incrivelmente afiada serra industrial. E as algemas? Elas também são reais. É possível ver que não há como escapar desta armadilha mortal em 30 segundos. E é realmente Mr. M quem está sobre a mesa. Mas ele está mesmo sendo cortado ao meio pela lâmina gigante da serra industrial? Não. Mr. M ainda tem muitos truques para revelar, começando por este. O primeiro segredo está na caixa que as assistentes trazem ao palco. Quando parece que Mr. M está se deitando dentro da caixa, na verdade está colocando as pernas em um compartimento secreto. As pernas da mesa são ocas e grandes o suficiente para uma pessoa. ou pelo menos metade dela. Deste ângulo é possível ver que há espaço de sobra para as pernas do mágico no compartimento, além de apoios muito úteis que funcionam como uma escada. A parte superior do corpo continua visível, mas e a outra parte? Nós vimos um corpo inteiro sobre a mesa, e as pernas parecem reais. O segredo é que um dublê já estava escondido na outra metade antes de o número começar. Suas pernas ficam sobre a mesa enquanto o resto do corpo está de cabeça para baixo no compartimento secreto. São as pernas do dublê que o público vê sendo imobilizadas. Mr. M fica na parte da frente, o dublê fica na parte de trás e as faixas de aço completam a ilusão. Com o dublê escondido antes de o número começar, o público não faz ideia de que será enganado. Mas como dois homens dão uma impressão tão convincente de um corpo? Quando as faixas de aço são erguidas, é possível ver o espaço entre eles. Quando são abaixadas, escondem a falha. O público acha que realmente está vendo o mágico inteiro. Mas a serra é real e a camisa de Mr. M realmente foi rasgada pela lâmina. O truque possui um risco real e, para garantir a segurança dos participantes, há uma falha entre as duas metades na mesa, permitindo que a serra atravesse a mesa diretamente. Há uma placa de madeira de cada lado para proteção. E quando as duas metades da mesa são separadas, parece que o mágico foi dividido em dois. Agora, você sabe como foi feito. Este truque simples com um palito de dentes pode ser realizado em uma festa. Mr. M demonstra que o palito é perfeitamente comum. Ele segura o palito e faz alguns gestos mágicos com a outra mão. Puf! O palito de dentes sumiu. Desapareceu sem deixar qualquer vestígio. Aonde ele foi? Como o Mr. M fez o palito desaparecer? O segredo é simples, mas muito eficaz. Tudo se resume a este pedaço de fita adesiva. Você só precisa da fita e do palito para realizar esse truque e surpreender seus amigos. Mr. M coloca o palito no começo da fita e dobra a ponta, mas não totalmente. A fita é presa ao seu polegar. Sem a luva, ela estaria exatamente sobre a unha. Perceba que o palito aponta para trás quando o dedo é aberto. Esta é a chave do truque. Mr. M retira o palito com cuidado, deixando a fita no polegar. Isso faz com que a fita forme um pequeno encaixe para o palito. Para fazê-lo desaparecer, o mágico só precisa abrir a mão e o palito sobe de vista, preso à parte de trás do polegar. Aqui podemos ver como o palito é colocado de volta dentro da fita. Este gesto normalmente é ocultado pelos outros dedos da mão. Agora ele irá abrir a mão lentamente para demonstrar o movimento do palito. Aí está, escondido na parte de trás do polegar. Do outro lado, é impossível perceber. Fazer um palito sumir é um truque que qualquer um pode realizar. Agora, Mr. M vai mostrar um dos truques improvisados mais populares de todos. Tudo que ele precisa para impressionar o público é um pouco de corda que o mágico mostra ser forte e comum e uma tesoura que irá aparecer em breve. Ele dobra a corda para encontrar o centro exato e então puxa a curva para a parte de cima da mão. Chegou a hora da tesoura. Eu disse que ela iria aparecer. O mágico utiliza a tesoura para cortar a corda ao meio com um pouco de esforço. Não foram utilizados truques de montagem. Isso é com certeza uma corda cortada. Ele então dobra as pontas cortadas, faz um gesto e, num passe de mágica, a corda está inteira. Mr. M conseguiu mais uma vez. Mas como ele conseguiu cortar a corda na metade e depois fazê-la se reconstituir? A resposta é que ele nunca chegou a cortar a corda. Este é o segredo. No começo do truque, há um pequeno pedaço de corda escondido dentro da mão do mágico, formando uma curva. Esta é a corda que é cortada pela tesoura. O mágico tem o cuidado de nunca deixar esta corda ser vista pelo público. Quando coloca a corda comprida na mão, ele puxa o pedaço pequeno por cima dos dedos. Deste ângulo, é possível acompanhar o movimento. A corda comprida fica presa no polegar, enquanto a curta fica visível na parte de cima da mão. Ele pega a tesoura e corta o pedaço curto de corda. Quando ele mostra as metades, parece que a corda comprida é que foi cortada. É bem convincente, na minha opinião. Tudo o que é preciso fazer é dobrar as partes cortadas e escondê-las dentro da mão. Ele as oculta antes de puxar a corda longa. E ninguém se preocupa em verificar a mão fechada. E é assim que se cria a ilusão de restaurar uma corda com mágica. Agora, Mr. M irá recriar mais um número clássico. Um dos mais famosos de todos. Ele mostra uma cadeira decorada que está sobre uma plataforma. Anda em torno da cadeira para que o público possa observá-la. E então, Mr. M chama uma de suas belas assistentes para que o público possa observá-la também. Sempre cavalheiro, Mr. M ajuda a assistente a subir na plataforma, onde ela se senta sobre a cadeira, como uma rainha em seu trono. Duas outras assistentes entram com um grande pano, e nós conhecemos Mr. M o bastante para saber que a mágica sempre acontece por baixo dos panos. As assistentes erguem o pano. Aqui está a mulher, ainda sentada. Mr. M precisava olhar para ela pela última vez, e eu não o culpo. O pano é erguido novamente e a assistente é coberta. Aí está ela, ainda sentada. Um gesto mágico, relâmpagos, e ela desapareceu. Sumiu num piscar de olhos, deixando para trás apenas Mr. M e sua cadeira elegante. Talvez seja melhor sentar para refletir sobre a situação. Como Mr. M fez sua bela assistente desaparecer? Não se preocupe, ela não está longe. Este é o segredo. Como sempre, o truque ocorre sob o pano. E várias coisas acontecem ao mesmo tempo. Primeiro, o assento da cadeira possui uma trava secreta e pode ser aberto. Quando o pano é erguido pela primeira vez, a assistente na cadeira abre o assento, permitindo que passe suas belas pernas por um alçapão escondido sob a plataforma. De cima, é possível ver como ela destrava o assento e entra no compartimento. Quando as outras assistentes abaixam o pano, a impressão é de que a mulher ainda está sentada na cadeira. Então, o pano é erguido novamente e cobre completamente a cadeira. Mas aquilo não é a assistente. Está vendo o retângulo preto no encosto da cadeira? É ali que está o segredo. Esta cabeça falsa. Ao ser posicionada, ela substitui a cabeça da assistente. E quando o pano é erguido novamente, Mr. M ergue secretamente a cabeça falsa, enquanto a assistente se esconde dentro da plataforma, sumindo de vista. Veja novamente de cima. A estrutura é posicionada e é coberta pelo pano. Para o público, parece que a mulher ainda está sentada na cadeira. Pelo jeito, ela sumiu. Mas onde estaria? A plataforma parece ser fina demais para escondê-la. Mas olhando de perto, é possível ver que é um pouco mais grossa do que aparenta. A assistente entra na plataforma e, deste ângulo, é possível ver que ela é oca com espaço suficiente para a assistente se esconder. Com as pernas de um lado, a mulher é capaz de curvar as costas e se encaixar do outro lado. Por fim, ela coloca o assento da cadeira de volta no lugar. E agora, a assistente está completamente oculta dentro da plataforma. Quando Mr. M puxa o pano para trás, o movimento faz com que a cabeça falsa volte à sua posição original atrás do encosto. E a mulher sumiu, deixando Mr. M sozinho para refletir sobre o que fez. Agora, Mr. M irá demonstrar uma mágica clássica e simples, utilizando um copo de vidro, uma moeda e um lenço de borracha. A moeda é colocada sobre o lenço de borracha que Mr. M estica sobre a boca do copo. Ele aponta para a moeda, o que na linguagem de Mr. M significa preste atenção. Um gesto mágico, e ele começa a esfregar a moeda suavemente. Até que... ela sumiu. Onde está? Ele retira o lenço de borracha e aí está ela, no fundo do copo. Uma moeda de verdade capaz de atravessar magicamente um lenço de borracha. Mas como Mr. M fez a moeda ir para o outro lado do lenço? Parece impossível, mas há um segredo. A borracha é um polímero especial de alta elasticidade do tipo usado por dentistas e pode ser bastante esticada sem arrebentar. É tão firmemente esticada sobre a moeda que se torna transparente, criando a ilusão de que a moeda está na parte de cima. Na verdade, está na parte de baixo. O lado com a moeda fica virado para dentro do copo. Quando Mr. M estica a borracha sobre o copo, a moeda parece estar sobre a borracha. Mas, na realidade, está presa do outro lado. Quando ele bate na moeda com o dedo, é possível ver que isso faz com que ela se solte da borracha e caia no fundo do copo. Um truque simples para quem conhece o segredo. Nós sabemos que mágicos mundialmente famosos usam seus truques para impressionar top models e belas estrelas de cinema, da mesma forma que alguns homens usam carros de luxo para impressionar mulheres boas demais para eles. Hoje, Mr. M irá utilizar as duas coisas. Ele apresenta um luxuoso Bentley. Eu disse um Bentley, porque não tenho certeza se o carro é mesmo dele. Mas tudo bem, top models geralmente não pedem para ver os documentos do carro. E além do preço, não há nada de extraordinário neste carro. Agora, as assistentes. Um desfile de beldades. Mas as mulheres que Mr. M quer impressionar hoje são estas belas modelos. Dá pra ver o porquê. Mr. M irá tentar transformar as fotos em mulheres de verdade. Afinal, as modelos verdadeiras são bem mais impressionantes do que apenas as fotos. E chegou a hora da mágica. Como sempre, há um grande pano envolvido. Parece que Mr. M possui vários panos gigantes guardados para qualquer emergência. Ele gosta de se precaver. As assistentes cobrem o Bentley. Mr. M se aproxima e pede que o público preste atenção no carro de luxo. As assistentes erguem o pano por um momento. E depois cobrem o carro novamente. Alguma coisa mudou. Vamos dar uma olhada? Em um passe de mágica, o Bentley se transformou em uma elegante Lamborghini completa com as belas modelos. Isso sim é um truque impressionante. Excelente, Mr. M. Uma visão espetacular. Muito bom. Então, como Mr. M juntou um Bentley comum de 200 mil dólares, duas fotos de modelos e transformou tudo em uma Lamborghini contendo as duas modelos reais? O segredo é simples e começa com o fato de que este número só pode ser realizado para a televisão. No começo do truque, Mr. M exibe o luxuoso Bentley para a câmera. É possível ver este lado do veículo, mas perceba que o mágico não convida a câmera para olhar do outro lado. E isso tem um motivo. O segredo do truque é que a Lamborghini estava estacionada ali desde o começo, com as belas passageiras já sentadas. Antes de o truque começar, um contra-regra estaciona o Bentley no lugar. Perceba como ele é maior que a Lamborghini. A Lamborghini foi escolhida por seu visual, mas também porque é bem menor que o Bentley e mais fácil de ocultar quando os dois estão lado a lado. Quando Mr. M está andando em volta do carro, ele mostra casualmente que não há nada do outro lado. Mas deste ângulo, é possível ver que ele está apenas gesticulando como se nada houvesse mais para ver ali. Mas com os dois carros posicionados, como Mr. M fez o Bentley sumir? O segredo está escondido dentro do Bentley. Um contra-regra oculto no banco do motorista. Sorria! Enquanto isso, as estonteantes modelos esperam dentro da Lamborghini. Todo aquele número com as fotos é apenas um modo de convencer o público de que talvez elas apareçam dentro do Bentley. Em seguida, as assistentes cobrem o Bentley com um pano. Neste momento, um contra-regra liga alguns ventiladores potentes para encher o pano de ar. É então que Mr. M se posiciona cuidadosamente do lado esquerdo da tela para ocultar o que está realmente acontecendo. Enquanto ele esconde a lateral esquerda do pano, o Bentley é simplesmente levado embora. Assim que ele sai, a câmera e o mágico se aproximam do outro carro, criando uma ilusão de ótica no momento em que as assistentes puxam o pano para cobrir a Lamborghini. Deste ângulo é possível ver o quanto elas se deslocam. Então, o contra-regra desliga os ventiladores e as assistentes colocam o pano sobre a Lamborghini. Mr. M manda retirar o pano, revelando o carro e as belíssimas modelos. A transformação terminou. E eu gostei do resultado, especialmente agora que conheço o segredo.
É o programa que mágicos do mundo inteiro não querem que você veja. Mr. M está de volta mais uma vez, ameaçando expor os segredos mais bem guardados do mundo. Você irá descobrir como são feitas aparições incríveis, fugas audaciosas, levitações impressionantes, desaparecimentos inexplicáveis, truques fascinantes e ilusões impossíveis. Nenhum mágico é famoso demais. Nenhum truque é grande demais. Nenhum segredo é sagrado demais. Os segredos dos mágicos sempre serão revelados pelo grande Mr. M.
No próximo número, Mr. M irá utilizar esta simples lata de refrigerante. Ele a segura delicadamente entre os dedos das mãos. Ele sopra sobre a lata, que de repente começa a levitar. Esse refrigerante deve ter muito gás. Ele segura a lata antes que ela suba demais. E ela está tentando fugir de novo. Se Mr. M não tomar cuidado, a lata pode voar para longe. Mas parece que está tudo sob controle. Quem diria que um refrigerante poderia ser tão leve? Como Mr. M fez a lata flutuar? O segredo está na ponta de seu dedo. Por trás é possível ver que a lata está presa ao polegar de Mr. M, utilizando um polegar falso feito de plástico e da mesma cor que sua mão. Quando ele é colocado sobre o polegar verdadeiro, é praticamente invisível. Na ponta do polegar falso há uma ventosa transparente. Ela se gruda à lata e Mr. M pode criar a ilusão de que a lata está levitando. Deste ângulo é possível ver que ele está apenas erguendo a lata com o polegar. Com os dedos esticados, tudo que Mr. M precisa fazer é usar um pouco de atuação para dar a impressão de que a lata está tentando fugir dele. Agora você sabe o segredo. Mr. M exibe seu mais novo aparato. Um palco elevado, pronto para uma apresentação de música e de mágica. Ele convida um quarteto de cordas a se posicionar sobre o palco. Eles sobem as escadas e tomam seus lugares ao mesmo tempo em que as assistentes chegam para ajudar no truque. Gravatas, borboleta e reverências. Que formalidade! Hora do show. Esse tipo de apresentação é raro de se ver. Aproveite enquanto pode. Uma cortina é erguida. E então, abaixada. Aonde eles foram? Ainda é possível ouvir a música, mas o quarteto sumiu. O mágico faz um gesto e a cortina sobe novamente. E quando ela é abaixada, eles voltaram. Eles continuam tocando e continuam elegantes. É emocionante. Mr. M conseguiu mais uma vez. O que aconteceu quando Mr. M supostamente fez os músicos desaparecerem? Eles conhecem o segredo, então por que não dividir conosco? O quarteto se posiciona e começa a tocar quando a cortina sobe. É então que acontece o truque. A plataforma foi construída sobre um eixo giratório. Atrás do palco há um grupo de contrarregras robustos. Assim que a cortina sobe, eles usam toda a força para puxar uma barra de aço soldada na parte de trás do palco. Isso faz com que a plataforma inteira gire 90 graus. Os membros do quarteto agora estão tocando deitados. Quando a cortina é abaixada, o público está vendo uma réplica da plataforma. Veja novamente, de cima. Se segurem, rapazes. As escadas e o pano preto na parte da frente ocultam a réplica da plataforma do público. Veja a troca novamente, de frente, sem a cortina para esconder a mágica. Esses contra-regras já estão merecendo um aumento, hein? Quando a cortina é erguida pela segunda vez, os contra-regras ganham mais um exercício. Eles empurram os músicos de volta para o lugar bem a tempo para serem revelados pela cortina. E este é o segredo de como fazer um quarteto desaparecer. E agora, um truque utilizado por mágicos de rua para convencer o público de que eles possuem poderes sobrenaturais. São necessárias apenas uma garrafa vazia e uma tampinha dobrada. Mr. M bate a tampinha no fundo da garrafa para provar que é sólido. Mas veja. Com a tampinha sobre os dedos, ele continua a bater, até que ela entra na garrafa. A tampinha de metal atravessou o vidro sem quebrá-lo. Parece bem mágico para mim. Talvez ele realmente possua poderes sobrenaturais. Então, Mr. M realmente possui poderes mágicos ou isto é apenas mais um de seus truques? Você já deve saber a resposta. O primeiro segredo está em seu anel. Ele é um ímã forte o suficiente para atrair a tampa de metal. O segundo segredo é a própria tampinha, ou o fato de que ele possui duas tampinhas. No início do truque, uma das tampinhas já está dentro da garrafa, sendo segurada pelo anel magnético. A outra tampinha é lançada para cima e apanhada pelo anel, ao mesmo tempo em que a de dentro é solta. Isso dá a impressão de que a tampa atravessou o vidro, mas o público está apenas vendo a tampa que estava dentro da garrafa desde o começo. Ele não irá mais nos enganar com esse truque, porque nós sabemos o segredo. Agora, Mr. M irá fazer seu corpo atravessar um objeto sólido. Neste caso, uma barreira gigante feita com dois contêineres de transporte empilhados. Às vezes, os mágicos atravessam paredes de tijolo, monumentos ou mesmo a maior muralha de todas. Mas nós não estamos na China. Então, nesse galpão, esses contêineres de aço com mais de 2 toneladas serão o suficiente. A proposta é utilizar mágica para atravessar a barreira de aço. Mr. M sobe em uma plataforma elevada para examinar melhor os contêineres. Eles não são feitos de pedra como a muralha da China, mas aço é tão sólido quanto. Mr. M avalia seu obstáculo e bate na lateral para provar que os contêineres de aço são reais. Atravessá-los será um verdadeiro desafio. Ele desce as escadas e seus assistentes abaixam as cortinas que estão presas na estrutura de aço da plataforma. Estas cortinas irão proteger o segredo do truque dos bisbilhoteiros. Mas não se preocupe, cedo ou tarde, Mr. M irá revelar o segredo. A cortina de trás possui um buraco para que um facho de luz ilumine a cortina da frente. Apesar de Mr. M não querer que o público veja tudo, ele irá permitir que sua sombra seja vista na cortina. Há uma estrutura idêntica do outro lado dos contêineres. Você irá vê-la em instantes. Dizem que Sir Arthur Conan Doyle, o criador de Sherlock Holmes, acreditava que o grande Houdini era capaz de se desmaterializar e atravessar objetos sólidos. Será que Mr. M pode nos fazer acreditar também? Agora que os assistentes já terminaram seu trabalho, Mr. M se prepara para se esconder atrás da cortina. É a última vez que iremos vê-lo antes que ele surja do outro lado. Se conseguir, claro. Aí está a sombra de Mr. M. Ele se concentra e força sua mão contra a parede do contêiner de aço. Agora a outra mão. E então o corpo todo. Será que ele dominou o segredo da desmaterialização de Houdini? Parece que ele sumiu, mas os céticos do público podem querer uma prova mais concreta. Pronto, aí está. Sem cortinas e sem mágico. Ou ele desapareceu, ou está atravessando o aço, partícula por partícula. Agora o desafio é reaparecer do outro lado. A câmera segue o caminho do mágico pelos contêineres. Lembre-se, os contêineres foram examinados e não existe nenhuma porta secreta. Do outro lado, os assistentes colocam um painel de pano branco sobre a parede do contêiner. O que é isso? Parece que as mãos de Mr. M estão surgindo sob o pano, tentando escapar da parede de aço. Ou seria Houdini que se levantou dos mortos? É perturbador. É melhor o deixar sair. O painel é retirado, mas não há sinal de Mr. M? Muito estranho. Mais uma vez, uma cortina é pendurada na frente da estrutura para proteger o segredo da reaparição. Ele conseguirá atravessar o aço. Se não conseguir, é melhor alguém ir buscar um pé de cabra. Outra cortina fecha a lateral. É possível ver que não há nenhuma sombra dentro e nenhum sinal de Mr. M ainda. Os assistentes terminaram seu trabalho e chegou a hora de o mágico reaparecer. Vamos lá, Mr. M. Se o Houdini conseguiu, você também consegue. Aí está ele. Atravessando lentamente o aço sólido. Eu não sei vocês, mas eu sempre soube que ele iria conseguir. Se bem que eu li o roteiro antes. As cortinas são retiradas e surge Mr. M depois de atravessar um enorme contêiner de aço. Mas é claro que há uma explicação. Este é o segredo. Quando Mr. M nos mostrou que os contêineres são reais, ele não mentiu. São de aço de verdade. Portanto, ele nunca seria capaz de atravessá-los como a sombra sugeriu. O que você não sabe é que há um dublê escondido em um compartimento sob a plataforma. Assim que as cortinas são colocadas, o dublê abre a porta e se prepara para seu papel secreto. Mr. M sobe as escadas. O facho de luz é focado diretamente na cortina, criando um espaço para que o dublê se esconda. Quando Mr. M entra atrás da cortina, ele toma o lugar do dublê, que dá um passo à frente. A troca é sutil e o dublê parece ser Mr. M. Enquanto isso, o verdadeiro Mr. M sai por outra porta secreta e se esconde na escada que utilizou para subir na plataforma. O público presta atenção na sombra e não percebe a fuga de Mr. M. Após se esconder, ele está pronto para ser levado até seu local de destino do outro lado dos contêineres. E sempre que as assistentes estiverem conduzindo escadas por aí, pode apostar que há alguém dentro delas. Na cortina iluminada, o público vê a sombra do dublê desaparecer na parede. De cima, é possível ver a coreografia do dublê que finge estar atravessando a parede e depois se esconde no canto, onde não será atingido pela luz. Mas de frente, parece que ele atravessou diretamente o aço. Em seguida, entra novamente em seu esconderijo para que o cubo esteja vazio quando as cortinas forem retiradas. O público acredita que Mr. M sumiu dentro da parede, mas o dublê está simplesmente escondido na plataforma. Enquanto isso, a escada onde Mr. M está escondido chegou ao outro lado dos contêineres. E enquanto ele se esgueira da escada para a plataforma, os assistentes distraem o público com seu próprio truque. Lembra-se do painel de pano encostado na parede do container? Olhando com atenção, é possível notar que apenas um braço de cada assistente está visível. Isso porque os outros estão atrás do painel. Eles estão pressionando as mãos contra o pano. A visão das mãos no pano é tão desconcertante que o público não pensa que podem ser as mãos dos assistentes e não as mãos de Mr. M. Assim que recebem o sinal de que Mr. M está pronto dentro da plataforma, eles retiram o painel e penduram as cortinas na estrutura. Com as cortinas no lugar, Mr. M sai do compartimento secreto e se esconde em um canto escuro, tomando cuidado para evitar a luz. Ele ergue os braços e anda para frente, criando a ilusão de que está atravessando o aço e reaparecendo do outro lado dos contêineres. É nesse momento que as aulas de atuação ajudam bastante. O truque terminou. E agora você conhece o segredo.
Vamos falar um pouquinho mais sobre a trajetória de Mr. M, o inimigo número 1 dos mágicos.
É o programa que mágicos do mundo inteiro não querem que você veja. Mr. M está de volta mais uma vez, ameaçando expor os segredos mais bem guardados do mundo.
Pra quem não sabe quem ele é, Mr. M era um nome artístico usado por um mágico de Los Angeles aqui no Brasil. Esse cara ficou muito conhecido no Brasil porque ele revelava números clássicos de ilusionistas profissionais, como a mulher serrada ao meio, a guilhotina, o coelho que aparecia na cartola e muitos outros números. Tudo isso escondido atrás de uma máscara bem macabra, por sinal. Ou seja, ele revelava as mágicas, mas não revelava a sua identidade. Ninguém sabia quem era a pessoa por trás daquela máscara do Mr. M. Antes de ser conhecido como Mr. M, ele trabalhava como um mágico comum, sem máscaras, e usava o pseudônimo de Val Valentino. Mas esse, ao contrário do que muitos pensam, não era o seu nome real. Leonard Montano, esse é o nome verdadeiro do Mr. M.
Palheiro, Mr. M ajuda a assistente a subir na plataforma, onde ela se senta sobre a cadeira, como uma rainha em seu trono.
Domingo à noite era de lei, começava o Fantástico, todo mundo, o Brasil parava para assistir as mágicas e as revelações do Mr. M. Ele era o cara da época, ele era a pessoa mais falada em 1999 aqui no Brasil. Como todo mundo sabe, os mágicos odeiam que revelem seus segredos, por isso a Rede Globo tomou uma série de processos naquela época. Mas isso não passava nem perto do número de ameaças de morte que o Mr. M sofria de outros mágicos. Profissionais que trabalhavam com mágica revelam que foi complicadíssimo continuar vivendo da mágica naquela época.
Na época que ele apareceu, os nossos shows caíram.
A cada nova aparição do Mágico Mascarado na televisão era uma série de shows a menos que os mágicos faziam. Deve ter sido muito complicado para os mágicos na época, eu entendo. Mas tudo tem um lado positivo e eu vou tentar ilustrar para vocês como o Mr. M foi muito importante para o crescimento da mágica mundial. Quando ele revelava o segredo de uma mágica, automaticamente os mágicos tinham que tirar esse número de seus repertórios. Mas imagine só você ter que tirar uma mágica por semana do seu show. Ia chegar uma hora que você não ia ter mais mágicas para apresentar, concorda? Foi aí então que os mágicos tiveram que se reinventar e criar novas técnicas e métodos para realizar números antigos que o Mr. M estava revelando. Mas o melhor de tudo isso é que os mágicos foram forçados a começar a criar números novos e abandonar aqueles números antigos. Se hoje o close-up magic, ou a mágica de proximidade, é tão valorizado no Brasil e no mundo, muito se deve ao fato do Mr. M ter revelado aquelas mágicas gigantescas que a galera já estava começando a ficar um pouco cansada de assistir. E que chegou um momento que o público queria ver coisa diferente, e o close-up veio pra isso. Eu acredito que por mais que você goste ou não do Mr. M, isso não importa, é inegável que ele deixou um legado muito importante pra mágica. A gente pode dividir a mágica até em duas fases, a mágica pré-Mr. M e a época pós-Mr. M. Seguindo essa linha de que tudo que é misterioso gera curiosidade, tudo que gera curiosidade gera audiência, a galera começou a parar de se preocupar tanto com as mágicas que o Mr. M estava revelando, e agora eles queriam revelar a sua identidade, ou seja, queriam que ele tirasse a máscara e mostrasse quem era o Mr. M. Isso lá em 1999, 2000. Parece que a primeira pessoa a fazer isso foi o Gugu no SBT, mas o Fantástico também mostrou na sequência, ou antes eu não lembro direito. Isso aconteceu mais 277 vezes depois. Toda vez que ele aparecia num programa de televisão, ele fingia revelar o seu rosto pela primeira vez. Eu juro pra vocês que eu já vi mais o rosto do Mr. M do que o rosto do Slash. Dizem que hoje ele tá completamente falido, mas em 2014 um programa da Record também foi até a casa dele em Las Vegas, ou melhor, a suposta casa dele, vocês vão entender já já o porquê, e mostraram uma realidade bem diferente. Mostraram o Mr. M com uma casa milionária, com uma estrutura, com carros e tal, mas daqui a pouco eu vou mostrar pra vocês parte por parte dessa matéria que a Record fez, e vocês vão ver que ela foi completamente forjada, que ela é uma matéria fake, sensacionalista, pra mostrar uma realidade que não era nem um pouco a realidade do Mr. M. Vocês vão entender já já o porquê. No ano passado, Mr. M revelou que ele estava com uma doença terminal e que ele só tinha mais um ano de vida. E o complicado dessa história é que ele se recusou a fazer o tratamento da sua doença, que se tratava de um câncer de próstata. Ele só revelou ter essa doença ano passado, mas parece que já fazia uns 5 anos que ele sabia disso. Só agora ele resolveu que quer fazer a cirurgia e quer se tratar. Mas depois de muito tempo sem poder trabalhar, com fortes dores, sem poder viajar a trabalho, ele está completamente falido, não tem dinheiro para pagar a sua cirurgia. E como ele não tem o dinheiro para pagar essa cirurgia, um amigo dele aqui do Brasil, um brasileiro chamado Fernando, resolveu fazer uma vaquinha pra galera colaborar com o tratamento do Mr. M. Como eu disse, em 2014 foi pro ar uma matéria na Record onde eles iam até Las Vegas, nos Estados Unidos, mostrar a casa do Mr. M. Eu resolvi assistir essa matéria de novo porque pra mim não era possível. Em 2014 ele tá milionário com uma casa daquela e agora ele tá falido. Mas aí eu comecei a perceber vários erros que provam que essa matéria foi completamente forjada, falsa, muitos erros, e eu vou mostrar alguns pontos para vocês perceberem também como ela foi mal feita e como ela era sensacionalista. Eu vou mostrar aqui para vocês, eu separei alguns trechos dessa matéria que eles fizeram na TV Record, acho que aquele Geraldo Luiz, com o nome dele e tal.
O acordo que foi feito entre a produção de Val Valentino e a minha produção do Domingo Show foi a seguinte: não mostrar principalmente o trajeto do deserto até a casa de Val Valentino. Conhece este deserto?
Bom, nesse momento é o seguinte, eles pegam um carro no centro de Las Vegas com o motorista do Mr. M, que vai ter que levar eles até um deserto. Eles vão ficar nesse deserto até que outro carro vá buscar eles para levar até a casa do Mr. M. Vocês vão entender agora, olha só. E aí ele tá no meio do deserto quando ele olha, ó. E avista alguma coisa.
Meu câmera, tem um carro lá na frente, lá em cima, lá no ponto. Tem um carro que parou. Dá uma olhada.
E aí chega um carro para buscar eles. Olha isso, que bizarro. O carro chega para buscar eles. Tudo misterioso, ninguém sabe a hora que vai chegar, quem que vai vir e tal. Aí o carro chega e já tem uma câmera posicionada atrás da pessoa que vai buscar eles. Como? O câmera tava conversando com ele no meio do deserto. Ok? Chega o carro que eles estavam esperando e já tinha uma câmera ali atrás da mulher posicionada. Hora que ela começa a chamar eles. Hã? Mas beleza, tem coisa pior por vir. Agora beleza, eles chegaram, já foram apresentados pro Mr. M e tal. E eles vão... E o Geraldo olha para um piano e vai perguntar sobre esse piano. E aí ele vai mexer num papel ali, tá vendo? E o Mr. M não deixa ele encostar nesse papel, porque ele fala que são fotos da família dele e ele não quer mostrar as fotos da família dele por questão de privacidade e segurança. Mas dá uma olhada num detalhe que eu reparei aqui. Ele fala que ele tem uma filha e que a filha dele toca piano. E aí ele começa a pegar as fotos e, meu, dá uma olhada. Uma casa, é que vocês não viram a casa inteira ainda. Mas uma casa milionária, o cara tem porta-retrato que vende no R$ 1,99. Olha que ridículo os porta-retratos dele. Porta-retratos, porta-retratos. Olha que porta-retrato ridículo. Que coisa mais feia. Uma pessoa milionária não tem um porta-retrato feio desse de R$ 1,99 na casa dele. Ou seja, eles forjaram todo um cenário em cima daquele piano que já devia estar naquela casa que foi alugada por eles. Para fazer essa matéria, ou seja, eles alugaram uma casa lá nos Estados Unidos para fingir que era uma casa do Mr. M. E aí compraram, acharam umas fotos, acho que na internet, de uma criança. Compraram um porta-retrato horrível e botaram a foto de uma criança aqui e falaram que é a filha dele. Meu, eles estão mentindo desde o começo da matéria. Só faltava estar com o preço, né, atrás, em reais ainda, para mostrar que o negócio foi comprado no Brasil. Agora, é uma das partes mais legais que eu vi aqui. Assim, ele vai falar uma coisa interessante sobre como surgiu a máscara dele, mas antes disso, olha onde o cara guarda a máscara, uma das máscaras mais famosas do mundo, ou pelo menos do Brasil. Olha como ele guarda largada no quarto dele, no closet dele. Dá uma olhada. Você acha mesmo que o Mr. M guardaria a máscara dele assim, ó, jogada no armário? Que não teria um lugar da hora na parede com as máscaras e tal. Mas agora ele fala sobre a ideia da máscara, de quem foi a ideia, se liga.
We hired a Hollywood professional.
Eles empregaram uma pessoa profissional de Hollywood, de filmes, para fazer a máscara.
That does designs for Spider-Man, Batman, all of the movies.
Faz os designs para todos os filmes, como Homem-Aranha.
Eu não sei se isso é mentira também, mas ele conta aqui que a pessoa que ajudou ele a criar a máscara dele, uma pessoa de Hollywood que também fez a máscara, por exemplo, do Homem-Aranha. Eles mentiram tanto nessa matéria que eu duvido muito disso também, mas ok. Aí fica aí uma curiosidade sobre o Mr. M. E agora ele vai mostrar o rosto dele de novo, depois de muitos anos e tal. Isso foi em 2014, olha como ele ainda estava jovem, como ele ainda estava conservado. No final desse vídeo eu vou mostrar para vocês como ele tá hoje em dia, magro, debilitado e dá muito dó do Mr. M. Mas é isso. Ah, mais uma parte legal aqui para encerrar, essa é muito engraçada. O cara tá na casa dele, ele vai voltar para casa dele, encerrou a matéria e tal, ele vai abrir a porta. Repara que ele não sabe qual das duas portas ele tem que abrir, qual lado da porta ele tem que abrir. E o pior, o cara, na própria casa, não sabe se a porta é de empurrar ou de puxar. Tanto é que a porta é de empurrar e ele tenta puxar. Isso só prova que a casa não era do Mr. M. Dá uma olhada. Ele tenta puxar a porta duas vezes e depois ele empurra. E entra na casa. Ah, mágico dos mágicos. Bom, chega de mostrar essa matéria sensacionalista aqui do Mr. M e mal feita. E vamos voltar para outra parte do vídeo que a gente estava falando mais sobre ele e sobre o que está acontecendo com ele. E fica aqui então com um recado que o Mr. M deixou para os brasileiros em um dos programas, acho que da Record também.
Nos últimos 5 anos, eu tive sérios problemas de saúde. E por 3 anos, passei por vários médicos, eles não conseguiam descobrir o que estava errado. Dois anos atrás, eu fui diagnosticado com algo muito ruim na próstata. Não vou falar o nome. O urologista que descobriu me disse que eu teria menos de um ano e que eu teria que ser operado ou estaria morto. A única coisa que ele poderia fazer era a cirurgia, quimioterapia, radioterapia, e eu não queria fazer isso. Então perguntei quanto tempo eu teria. Seria um ano. E fui embora do consultório. Não tomei a medicação que ele gostaria que tomasse, por causa dos efeitos colaterais, que eram terríveis. Um ano depois do diagnóstico, e eu continuava vivo. Isso foi incrível. Nós estamos falando sobre 5 anos, não tendo condição de trabalhar, porque eu não tinha como entrar num avião, porque a próstata inchava e tinha outros problemas. Eu não tinha energia e não conseguia me apresentar. Então, eu acabei com as minhas economias, ainda tinha que manter a casa, cuidar dos meus filhos e da família. Cheguei num ponto em que, graças ao Fernando, ele arrumou as coisas para me ajudar a recuperar as minhas perdas, colocar a minha saúde em dia, conseguir as cirurgias e remédios de que eu precisava e manter a minha saúde o melhor possível, para que possa voltar a atuar. Quando isso acontecer, eu quero vir ao Brasil primeiro. Eu também gostaria de agradecer a todos vocês que contribuírem com isso, para eu poder conseguir fazer as minhas cirurgias. E eu só me sinto tão abençoado. Eu amo todos vocês. O Brasil sempre foi uma segunda casa para mim, ou melhor, é a minha segunda casa. E seria o lugar onde eu viveria, se não morasse nos Estados Unidos. Eu amo vocês tanto e muito obrigado pelo apoio de vocês. Obrigado pelo apoio, Record TV. Vocês são demais. Obrigado por colocarem isso no ar. Eu não queria mostrar o meu rosto, porque eu envelheci. Estou muito magro. Os médicos querem que eu ganhe peso, mas eu não consigo. Mas estou me esforçando e vou ficar bem em breve. Meu amigo Fernando sempre me fala que eu não posso desistir. Tem um monte de gente que me ama no Brasil. E eu amo o Brasil. Por hora, é isso. Muito obrigado. Tchau.
That's not the case. Making his first appearance at our show is a very gifted magician who will astound us with some sleight of hand. He's a regular at the popular Magic Castle here in Los Angeles and at the Comedy and Magic Club in Hermosa Beach. Would you welcome Valentino?
We'll come back after this message.
For this next illusion, the magician has assembled a group of volunteers to witness the magic. This one will be performed in a completely empty parking lot in broad daylight to eliminate any possibility of trap doors, secret panels, mirrors, or other stage trickery. He arranges the witnesses in a circle around two large sheets. Like the Pied Piper, they follow him and do exactly what he says, taking their positions in a circle, completely surrounding the sheets. As we walk with him, we can see that the area around the circle of witnesses is completely clear and free from boxes, trucks, or other foreign objects, except for the witnesses, the assistants, and the camera crew. No one is allowed in this secured lot. Now that the magician is pleased with the placement of his spectators and satisfied that we have seen 360 degrees, he's ready to make some magic. He gives some instructions to his assistants, commanding them to raise the larger of the two sheets. We can see that aside from some long poles that are sewn inside to hold it upright, the sheet does not appear to be gimmicked in any way. We continue our walk with the magician, seeing exactly what the witnesses see. Nothing unusual here, other than a man in a red shirt and a scary black mask. We've now walked to the other side of the sheet. There's nothing extraordinary to report here. The magician commands his assistants to bring in the sides of the sheet, forming a large three-sided box. Now to close it up, he commands the smaller sheet to be raised to form the front of the box. Not much of a trick, but there it is, a big fabric box in the middle of a parking lot. Maybe he's not done. He tells his assistants to hang on firmly to the large sheets as they battle the wind. This is the high cost of doing a trick outside. One final command for the TV audience to keep our eyes on the box, and the magician prepares to reveal the results of his conjuring. Let's watch. What do you know? A 5-ton elephant. Where did he come from? He was definitely not on the witness list. The girls are impressed. Maybe the masked magician can do real magic after all. An elephant appears in broad daylight while surrounded by witnesses. Truly amazing. We just saw the masked magician arrange a circle of witnesses in an empty parking lot, surrounding two large sheets of heavy canvas. Then, the sheets were formed into a box. While completely surrounded, the magician produced a 5-ton elephant. So how does the magician make the elephant appear from nowhere, in the middle of the lot, while encircled by spectators? It sounds impossible. It is. Here are the secrets. First off, let's start with the group of spectators. The secret here is, they're all in on the trick. The magician has no trouble positioning them in a circle since they've been rehearsed. This 360-degree walk is designed to convince us that the parking lot is empty and free of wandering elephants. Next, the large sheet is raised. Again, we can see the surrounding parking lot appears empty, but appearances are deceiving. We know he had to be hiding somewhere in this vast, seemingly empty lot. But where? We've been looking at his hiding place the entire time. Don't you remember seeing it? You did. Constructed near a group of trees by the edge of the lot is a painted Hollywood backdrop and some fake trees. This is the elephant's hiding place. Sound far-fetched? It's true. And chances are, it fooled you. Even though this looks like a setup that a cartoon roadrunner might use to trick a wily coyote, it's actually an effective hiding place for the elephant and his trainer. No one would ever expect a real pachyderm could be stashed away behind some phony trees in the middle of a parking lot, completely undetected. But the farther away the camera travels, the more deceptive the phony setup looks. See it now? When you know it's there, it's much easier to spot. The trick is that you didn't see it the first time because you didn't know where to look. This continuous camera angle from the illusion is low and only shows the front side of the sheet. The trick only works from this perspective because as the sheet is raised, the elephant begins to approach from the rear. From this high angle, you can see the elephant walking toward the sheet as the fabric box is being constructed. From this low angle, the sheet is blocking the approaching elephant. The paid witnesses step aside to allow the elephant and his trainers some room to sneak through the circle. From the low angle in front, there's no sign of the elephant. Two stagehands who are dressed like spectators tear open the back of the fabric box and the elephant walks inside. The sheet is held together with long Velcro strips. As soon as the elephant is inside, the Velcro is quickly resealed. When the front sheet is lowered, it looks as though the elephant has appeared from out of the blue. And that's the secret to making an elephant appear from nowhere.
It's the show that magicians around the globe don't want you to see. The Masked Magician is back, out of hiding, daring to expose the world's most highly guarded secrets. You'll find out how they perform amazing appearances, death-defying escapes, baffling levitations, astounding vanishes, mind-blowing sleight of hand, and impossible illusions. No magician is too famous. No trick too big. No secret too sacred. The magician's code will be forever broken on magic's biggest secrets finally revealed. Magician pulls back the curtain and exposes the secrets to enduring an encounter with a razor-sharp guillotine, Houdini's death-defying milk can escape, causing a beautiful woman to appear and disappear at will, surviving strangulation by a steel chain, commanding a stage full of sexy dancers to vanish in the blink of an eye. Plus, the truth behind how a man can levitate three stories above the ground. And much more. Right now on Magic's Biggest Secrets Finally Revealed.
The magician is about to stare death in the face in the form of this imposing guillotine. Once used to behead dangerous killers, lawbreakers, and the wives of kings, the guillotine gained its gruesome infamy during the French Revolution. But that's enough of a history lesson. Tonight, the magician hopes to survive before he's history. He examines the execution device with its razor-sharp blade, which is designed to cleanly sever the head from an unfortunate body. To ensure a clean cut, the neck of the victim is held in place by this heavy wooden stock. Anyone who would get into a device like this voluntarily has to have confidence in his powers of escape or a death wish. Let's hope the girls know how to do the rest of his tricks. If this is going to be his swan song, what a way to go. The magician climbs up onto the table and bends down as the assistants raise the stock. He places his head through the hole so that his neck can be trapped between the wooden planks. Meanwhile, another assistant is securing his legs to the table with thick leather straps. The straps will hold the magician in place in case he has a last-minute change of heart. It will also prevent his body from flying off the table in the event the blade hits its target. Of course, all of these restraints will make his escape near impossible and that much more dangerous. Remember, a magician is a world-class professional. Don't try any of his dangerous illusions at home. With the wooden stocks in place and the leather straps cinched tightly around his body, it's time for the magician to begin his escape. That deadly blade is looming just a few feet from his neck. So why isn't he struggling to escape? Maybe he has a death wish after all. Let's watch. It's now or never. Oh no, he didn't get out. That wasn't supposed to happen. This is getting more grisly by the second. As the assistants cover his lifeless body with a sheet, one of the girls places his lifeless head on the table. Maybe it's not so lifeless after all. And now here are the secrets. The blade is real and therefore makes this trick very dangerous to perform. The timing is crucial and means the difference between life and death. The straps are real too, and the magician never leaves the table. What about the head? Well, that's the magician's real head we see falling into the basket. But how does he keep from losing his head while performing this trick? Let's start with the blade. When it drops, it stops against these steel blocks. The sharp edge never touches the magician. But if that's really his head falling into the basket, how does he create the illusion? The magician's neck and upper body drop down through this rubber collar that is painted to look like wood. It snaps closed again once his neck has passed through. Watch again in slow motion as his neck passes through the rubber collar and then snaps closed. And that's not really the blade inside the hole. From behind, we see this small board that is held up by the magician's neck. When he drops down, the board falls down too, creating the illusion that the blade is visible from behind the hole. From the front, it appears as though the blade has separated his head from his body. The table is rigged with a secret trap door that springs open with the action of the blade. Behind the blade is a metal rod. This rod continues to fall after the blade stops, triggering a switch on the table that releases the trap door. When this trap is released, the magician's torso falls down into the basket. But it appears as though his body is still lying on the bench. That's because hidden inside his jacket is a rigid body cast that simulates his back and shoulders. This shell creates the illusion of his body on the bench. Here's what it looks like without the jacket in place. But with the jacket on, it appears that his body never moves. But if his head isn't severed, what does the assistant take out of the basket? You guessed it. It's a fake head hidden by a mask identical to the magician's. Before the trick begins, the fake head and a red scarf are concealed in the basket out of the audience's view. After the magician drops down into the basket, the assistant simply reaches down around him and picks up the fake head and scarf and shows them to the audience. But how does this fake head magically come back to life? Of course, it doesn't. What you don't know is that the magician has an exact double. Well, almost exact. At least the mask is the same. Not only does the table have a trap door for the magician, it also has another secret. Beneath the table is a concealed hiding place for the double. She climbs in and waits patiently for her cue. She's hidden from the audience by this mirror, which reflects the floor beneath the table. Above, the table is equipped with flexible slats in the otherwise solid top. The rubber slats allow the double to pop her head up through the table. One assistant carries the fake head and scarf to the back of the table, while another girl is arranging an identical scarf around the rubber slats. While blocked from view, the assistant appears to place the head on the bench. Actually, she's walking away with it. With the slats disguised by the red scarf, all that's left for the double to do is open her eyes and give the audience the shock of their lives. And that's the secret to not losing your head. And now the magician has a little bit of sleight of hand using nothing more than a glass top table and this shiny penny. Take a good look at the penny. In fact, never take your eyes off of it. He taps the glass from underneath to prove that it's solid. We could already see that. Next, he taps the top and leaves the penny on the center of the table. With one palm directly below the glass, the magician covers the penny with his other hand. Now watch for the magic. His top hand is removed and we can see that the penny has melted through the glass and is now on his palm. It's not an illusion. It's definitely on the other side of the glass. A cheap trick with a penny that completely baffles the mind. How does the magician make the penny melt through the glass and wind up underneath on his open palm? You know there has to be a simple explanation. Here are the secrets. First, there are two pennies, and they're not even real. They're made of steel. Before the trick begins, the magician palms one of the fake coins in his left hand. He places the other coin on the solid glass table. The next secret involves the ring on his right hand. This ring holds a super strong magnet that is concealed beneath his fingers. That's why the fake pennies are made of steel. They're attracted to the magnet. When he holds the secretly palmed steel coin beneath the glass, he covers it with a magnet, which is powerful enough to attract the steel through the glass. Now that the palmed coin is hidden from view, all he has to do is slide it forward so that it's directly above his open palm. When he lifts his top hand away, the coin that's below the glass drops into his palm. At the same time, the steel coin on top of the table is attracted to the magnet. Take a penny, leave a penny, and that's how he makes it look like the coin passes through the solid glass.
Up next, the magician defies death and exposes Houdini's world-famous milk can escape. The shocking truth behind levitating three stories above the ground. Plus making gorgeous women appear and vanish without a trace.
Next, the magician has an illusion that's been baffling audiences for decades. Let's see if it will fool cultured, contemporary eyes. Sitting atop four legs is a fancy cabinet with a curtain across the front. When the curtain is opened, we can see that it appears empty. As we take a look around to the other side, we see that the back is also covered by a curtain. With both of them pulled open, we can see straight through the cabinet. Aside from the magician, there's nothing inside. Knowing how magic works, we can assume that this is only a temporary condition. Right on cue, two of his lovely assistants enter to lend a hand and, as always, some eye candy. This guy sure knows how to pick 'em. Back to the trick. The curtains are drawn and the magician cues the assistants to take the box for a little spin on the floor. This is usually when the magic happens. The front curtain is opened up and, yep, I was right. A bouquet of flowers. Not the most elaborate bouquet. Then again, the delivery was pretty fast. But the magician isn't satisfied with them, so he puts them back in the box. The curtain is drawn, and he gives the signal for the girls to rotate the box again. They're getting a workout tonight. It's time to open the curtain again to see what's up next. And look at this. Another beautiful girl. Maybe that's where he gets them. And she seems delighted by that pathetic bouquet. Just imagine what she would do if he gave her some roses. The curtain is drawn once again, depriving us of the view of the girl inside. The assistants go back into the routine while the magician makes his patented hand gestures. Let's see what's going to happen this time. A magical wave and there's the bouquet. Not exactly a great trick. Maybe she didn't like them after all. Let's take a look behind the curtain. The girl has vanished without a trace. Perhaps he should have sprung for the roses. or maybe even a ring. Well, he still has the other two, and that seems like more than enough for him to handle. Okay, let's recap. We saw that there was nothing in the cabinet at the start of the trick. After the required spin by the assistants, the flowers appeared. Another spin, then the beautiful girl appeared. After the final spin, when the curtains were opened, she was nowhere to be found. So how did the magician create this complex illusion? The secret is in the cabinet. There are some hidden panels that conceal the girl and her flowers. Before the trick begins, the girl folds up the side panel plus the panel in the floor and climbs in. She covers her legs with the floor panel and flips down the side panel so she can't be seen. As we can see, the curtain hides the fact that the right side of the box is much wider than it appears, giving the girl room to hide. When the curtain is closed the first time, the girl flips open the side panel and deposits the flowers. With the curtain opened, you can see how it works. The magician opens the curtain and finds that the flowers have appeared, as if by magic. When the assistants are spinning the box the second time, the girl inside the cabinet is opening both panels and climbing into place while the team outside is drawing our attention. This is where a small, flexible assistant comes in handy. She's only got a few seconds to get settled before her appearance. Let's watch with the curtain opened. She's got to be very agile and very fast. She also can't be claustrophobic. As we can see, there's barely enough space for the panel to flip down and clear her lovely legs. She gets into a seductive pose just in time for the magician to open the curtain. There she is. During the final turn, she reverses the process and climbs back into her secret compartment. From here, she's able to reach down and hand the flowers to the magician, creating the illusion that she's still in the cabinet. With the back curtain open, we can see how she flips up the side panel and reaches out with the flowers in her hand. Once he takes them from her, she flips the panel back down and is completely hidden from view. The curtain is open, and it appears that she has completely vanished. And that's how the magician makes a girl appear and disappear, while making her do all the work. Here's a simple trick that's very effective. The magician begins by showing us a length of ordinary string. And a plastic drinking straw. He feeds the string into the straw. And then demonstrates that it really goes in one side and comes out the other. He bends the straw in the center and tells us to watch closely, as if we had anything better to do. He picks up a sharp hobby knife and very carefully he cuts through the straw and the string. He separates the two halves of the straw to prove that the slice has gone all the way through. Uh-oh, here comes the magical waves. Something's gonna happen. He lays one straw on top of the other and pulls the string. Miraculously, it comes out in one long piece, just like it started. The straws go bye-bye and tug-tug. The string is good as new. Fooled us again, Masked Man, but how? What are the secrets to pulling off the brain twister of cutting through the straws and string, then revealing the string is good as new? You're about to find out. The straw is real, so is the knife. Before the trick begins, the magician secretly uses the knife to carefully slice a long slit lengthwise in the straw. See? He can open the straw and show you inside, but he never lets the audience see this. The slit is the first secret. The magician feeds the string into the straw. Yes, it's really going inside. He bends the straw in half. And when he tugs on both ends of the string at the same time, it pops out through the slit and will be concealed by his fingers. There's the string. And here's how he covers it up. Now, he takes the knife, cuts through the straw, and presumably the string. In reality, the string is safe and sound below the blade. See? It is still fed through the two remaining ends of the straw. With his finger covering the string, it looks like two separate pieces hanging from inside the straw. The magician then stacks the straws, being careful not to let the middle of the string show, as it does here. He pulls the end of the string, and it easily slides out in one long piece. He discards the pieces of straw so they can't be examined, and turns all eyes to the undamaged string. It's in one piece, thanks to the secrets.
Up next, after a century of silence, one of Houdini's most famous escapes will be exposed at last. Plus the secrets behind a beloved classic trick. Then find out how to make a line of sexy chorus girls disappear. And we solve the incredible mystery as to how street magicians perform amazing outdoor levitation.
The masked magician will now attempt to perform one of Harry Houdini's most famous escapes. The one that was once promoted with the slogan, "Failure means a drowning death." The magician displays a large milk can that's been filled with water. This particular can has a bulletproof plate glass window, an aftermarket addition, so that we can see what the magician is up to once he's inside. His beautiful assistants remove the lid, and I think you can guess what's going to happen next. The magician steals his courage and squeezes into the can of water. In Houdini's day, shipping milk in these large metal barrels was commonplace, so milk cans weren't out of the ordinary. However, attempting to escape from one filled with water was quite an unthinkable act. It's a tight fit, but he manages to fit his arms inside and force himself down. The water cascades to the floor. It's real, all right, and wet. Step back, ladies. The magician will take a few deep breaths before he can plunge all the way into the can. That mask isn't helping matters either. He'll test his ability by trying to hold his breath in this very intimidating can. Try to hold your breath with him. His assistants place the metal lid in place. There he is, behind the glass. Remember what I said about drowning? It's important to remember that this is a world-class magician, and at no time should you attempt any of his dangerous tricks at home. The magician is doing a test run of his lung power, only to see how long he can last once he's really locked inside. How about you? Are you still holding your own? He seems to be doing okay, but remember, his hands will be shackled just like Houdini's were 100 years ago. It's nearly a minute now. That's about all he can take. His assistants remove the lid, and it seems like he's happy to be breathing again. Did you last as long as he did? He's shaken, but ready to go on. The extra hardware will make the escape even more death-defying. The magician willingly holds out his wrists for a pair of regulation police handcuffs. Wonder where she got those. Since Houdini was known as the Handcuff King, this is only fitting. A few more deep breaths, and the magician is again ready to squirm his way back into the can. lid is returned to its position. And this time, the assistants secure it with heavy-duty padlocks. They'd better hurry. Even experienced divers would find it terrifying to hold their breath while handcuffed and locked inside a cold steel can. Try holding your breath again and imagine that you've got no way out. Not so easy, is it? There we see him struggling with the handcuffs. Even if he smuggled a lockpick into the can, reaching the locks on the outside would be impossible. Houdini was right. Failure could mean a drowning death. He wrestles with the cuffs for a few more seconds. Maybe he needs some privacy. His assistants raise a curtain in front of the can. By now, he's been locked underwater for more than a minute and hasn't made any progress. This is longer than he lasted the first time before he had to be let out. He must be starting to panic. Are you still holding your breath? It's been 90 seconds now and still no sign of him. The assistants better do something. Get him out of there! He's safe. What a relief. I bet even Houdini didn't have a welcoming committee like this. So how did the magician escape before drowning in the old-time milk can? Here are the secrets. First off, the handcuffs look solid, but they've been specially rigged to pop open in an instant. Cuffs like these are almost always used in underwater escapes to minimize the risk of danger. When the magician first plunges into the can, he displaces a lot of water, leaving more room for air to breathe. It's a good acting job, but in reality, he has plenty of space to move freely. The first time we see him behind the glass, we're convinced that he has to hold his breath while inside the can. But check out the lid. The dome-shaped top allows him some extra room to reach up and take a breath whenever he needs to. While we're distracted by his hands behind the porthole, his head is safely above the waterline beneath this dome. Opening the lid to put on the handcuffs only adds more drama to the escape. The lid is locked into place with real padlocks that never get open. They don't have to, because the neck of the can is surrounded by a false collar, held on by these rivets. The assistants remove the rivets when they attach the locks. Here we see how easily the lid and the collar are removed. Next, the sheet is raised. The magician can see the sheet through the glass and knows that it's time to make his escape. He simply pushes up on the lid, and it effortlessly pops off, locks and all. All he has to do now is climb out of the can. Once the magician is outside, he replaces the lid and stands next to the can, waiting to make his miraculous appearance. The girls provide the hero's welcome, and the illusion is complete.
Up next, find out how the magician makes a line of dancing girls vanish in an instant and survives a solid steel chain being pulled through his neck. Plus, a classic of magic will be exposed. And then, the surprising truth behind an impossible levitation.
The magician will now demonstrate another of magic's most famous tricks. He picks up a small metal pan that's solid on the bottom and all the way around. With a lighter, he sets a small fire inside the pan, quickly covering it with a metal lid. Presto! Some flowers for his lovely ladies. But how did he do it? So how does the magician pull off the trick that's been amazing kids at birthday parties for years? Tonight, he reveals the secrets. First, as he's showing us the back of the empty pan, he's concealing a sheet of chemically treated flash paper inside. This is what he ignites with the lighter to cause the fire. When he uses the lid to smother the blaze, he's actually dropping a second pan inside. This pan is slightly smaller and fits snugly in the original pan. Until it's needed, the second pan is secretly held in the lid by these metal spring clamps. The pan snaps into the lid and is held tightly by the springs until they come in contact with the outer pan. This releases the springs, and the secret inner pan drops into place. Now for the flowers. They're made of folded pieces of tissue paper and also contain strips of spring steel. When released, they pop open. Before the trick begins, the magician carefully folds the flowers into the secret pan and loads it into the lid. During the trick, he smothers the fire, releases the secret pan, and reveals the paper flowers. Sometimes a dove or a small rabbit is inside, but either way, the secret is the same. The magician will now demonstrate an illusion that's designed to feature his four leggy assistants and their features. The girls step back up onto the stage as evidenced by their red patent leather boots. Take one last look. The magician commands the curtain to be lowered and raised. In a split second, all four women have vanished. A big finish to their routine, but not exactly what I had in mind. Pretty impressive, masked man. Now be a sport and show us what you did with the girls. So how did the magician make his four lovely dancing girls vanish in an instant? The secrets are something to see. First off, it involves the girls in their very stylish red leather boots. An identical set of four pairs of boots is concealed backstage. The back wall of the stage is built in two sections. When the curtain is lowered, a stagehand behind the wall released a mechanism that allows the top half to swing open. When the girls head back and appear to be walking up and across the stage, they're actually walking the duplicate boots in front of the wall, while they stay behind. Sweet. From the front, it looks like the girls are simply strutting into place behind the curtain. Without the curtain in place, we can see how clearly the girls manipulate the fake legs. These are the boots we see just below the bottom of the curtain. So we know that the girls are behind the wall and the fake legs are in front, but how does he make them vanish? There's another secret to these tricky boots. They have hooks built right in. See? I wouldn't lie. A pipe is lowered from the ceiling. Just as the top of the wall flips open, the girls have just enough room to hook the boots onto the pipe. By the time the curtain is being lowered, the boots are already hooked over the pipe. Just a split second before the curtain rises, the trick wall is closed and the pipe is raised, taking the boots along for the ride. Without the curtain in place, this is what the audience would see. Not very magical. All that's left for the magician to do is take the credit for a job well done by his assistants.
Up next, find out how the magician escapes the chains of death. And the amazing secret to an impossible levitation.
Something tells me this next trick is going to involve this sturdy length of chain. And lucky for us, the magician's lovely assistants. The magician tugs on the chain to prove that it's solid. He then drapes the chain over his head so that it rests behind his neck. Next, he wraps the chain one more time around his neck and pulls the two ends to the front. These ends he ties in a knot and hands to the two ladies. Trusting guy. One more look at the knot, and the magician steadies his nerves. The girls are ready. On his command, they pull the chain, and it magically passes right through his neck. He's unharmed. The chain and his neck are still in one piece. Now, here's the secret. The chain is real, and it's made of solid steel. It hasn't been prepared in any way. The key to this illusion is the manner in which the magician places the chain around his neck. By using some sleight of hand, the magician pretends to wrap the chain completely around his neck. It's pretty convincing. From this angle, you can see that the chain is merely wrapped to the back and looped, giving the impression that it completely circles his neck. From the front, it appears as though he's completing the circle with a dangerous knot. Instead, he's actually doubled back the chain so that it will easily slip to the front when the assistants pull on it. Here we can see that the loop is tucked behind his jacket to keep it hidden from view. When the assistants tug the chain, they're simply releasing the loop and pulling the chain to the front. Look closely and you can see the chain slipping around his neck, not through it, just like unraveling a sweater. This rear angle shows the direction of the chain as the loop is pulled out. The magician and the assistants have to take care while performing this trick since there is a real danger of the chain links getting tangled. If they do, this harmless illusion can quickly become a harmful strangulation. They've practiced many times, so don't try this one at home. Popular extreme magicians have been making themselves float through the air as proof of their unusual freakish powers. Tonight, the masked magician joins them. He's made his way to the top of his secret warehouse and intends to demonstrate the extent of his unique abilities in broad daylight. As you can see, he's completely alone on the roof, and there are no visible wires or hydraulic lifts around to aid him in his attempt to levitate. Watch carefully, and let's see if he's as good as the street magicians who claim they can do this for real. Wow, he's floating off the roof. Well, it certainly looks like he's floating, but that could be an illusion. Let's watch some more. He's now hovering over the building without any visible means of support. This actually does look pretty freaky. He's floating in midair. It's effortless. Maybe he's just thinking happy, wonderful thoughts like Peter Pan. He couldn't possibly be thinking about the three-story fall to the concrete below. As we can see from the back, he's not wearing any kind of James Bond jetpack. These incredible angles show a complete view of the magician and the area around him. He's achieving the impossible. Watch now as he begins to float down toward the earth with nothing above and nothing below to help him accomplish this trick through devious means. And there he is, safe on the ground.
The masked magician will expose the amazing truth behind his incredible levitation.
We just saw the masked magician climb to the roof of his secret warehouse, rise up and float effortlessly through the air without any visible means of support. These incredible angles show a complete view of the magician and the area around him. This feat is truly a miracle. Or is it? So how does the magician rise up off the roof and float through the sky like a superhero? The secret may come as a bit of a surprise, so I'll let you down easy. He doesn't have superpowers. He's not even in control of his own flight path. The man in charge is right here, sitting in the cab of a 50-foot crane. Dangling from the top of this crane is a set of very thin aircraft cables, the same kind used to make Peter Pan fly on Broadway and in theaters across the country and around the world. Concealed beneath the magician's jacket is a specially designed harness that has been used on stage for decades. Before the trick begins, the crane operator lowers the cables down to the stagehands who attach them securely to the harness. Once they're double and triple checked, the magician is ready to fly with the greatest of ease. But why don't we see the cables suspending him in the air? The secret is the bright sky. Remember I said he wanted to show you his power in broad daylight and that there were no visible wires? That's because the glare from the bright sun and sky makes the wires impossible for the cameras and even the human eye to detect. From the proper angle, the brightness of the sky blocks the cables, making them invisible. From this angle, you can see that the camera can pick up the wires, shattering the illusion. While demonstrating his supposedly magical abilities, we saw the magician alter his flight pattern with nothing above or near him. The secret here involves moving the crane. In between shots of the magician in the air, the crane was repositioned to allow the operator the freedom to fly the magician in different directions. Clever editing of the various angles makes it look like he's flying around the parking lot. The most difficult part of this trick is lowering the magician to a soft landing. How about that? It is done with wires after all.
Next time, the masked magician returns to reveal more of magic's biggest secrets.
Place it down on the rack. Here they can remove the hardened steel pins that secure the two halves of the cage. With the front half of the cage removed, we can see how something or someone can be placed inside. Here's someone now, and she's something. The girl assumes the position inside the back half of the cage, and it looks like there is barely enough room for her to make the tight squeeze. Now, two male assistants enter. As she steadies herself, they replace the front of the cage, trapping her inside. I'm getting uneasy just looking at the situation. The steel pins are replaced, and she struggles to find a comfortable arrangement. There isn't one. The male assistants lift the cage and place it into the heavy mount, along with its beautiful cargo. What happens next is anyone's guess. The magician removes the steel pins again and opens the clasps. The two halves separate, but the girl inside isn't going anywhere. His other assistants now cover the sections of the cage with heavy pieces of black canvas. They're careful to stretch the fabric tightly around the cage. Inside, you can bet that the cage is cramped and dark, and no place for a lovely lady to spend an evening alone. The magician motions for another assistant. This one comes bearing a razor-sharp cross-cut saw. Just when you thought this device couldn't get any more torturous. The magician steps behind the cage, and you got it. He begins to saw between the two halves and presumably the girl. This just isn't her day. It seems like he's having a hard time of it. She looked like a tough cookie. Remember, she's strapped inside with nowhere to go. He's made it all the way through and removes the saw. The assistants regroup. One takes the saw as the others remove the canvas. And there's the beautiful girl in the iron cage. Uncomfortable, but unharmed. So how did the magician make it look like the girl in the cage was sliced in two? Here are the secrets. The cage is, in fact, as sturdy as it appears. It's got to be in order to safely hold the girl inside. When she kneels down to climb in, she arches her back to fill the cage and make it look even harder than it is. As the halves are secured, she keeps her back arched, and the cage looks almost too small to contain her. But when she bends down, we can see that this is only an illusion. She has more room than we imagine. Once the cage is in its mount, the girl has plenty of room to roll over onto her back. In this position, she's able to slide some of the metal straps away, allowing her to drop down out of the bottom. As he saws, the magician uses his skills as a mime to make it look like he's struggling to cut through flesh and bone. In reality, the girl has rotated onto her back, slipped out of the secret metal bands, and lowered herself safely below the path of the saw. Who says show business isn't glamorous? Here's a look at her movements without the canvas. See, there are two sections that have been rigged to secretly slide away and give her enough room to slip down. In this provocative position, she's in no danger of being touched by the saw blade as it appears to cut through the gap in the cage. Good thing, because this is a real saw, and it does cut close. However, the teeth have been filed down to nothing with a power grinder, just to be on the safe side. By the time the assistants remove the fabric, the girl inside has replaced the sliding metal bands, flipped back onto her knees, and waits to once again fill the cage with her loveliness. And those are the secrets.
Next, the magician shows you how he can summon spirits from another world to leave their mark and plunge a rose through a girl without leaving his. Plus, find out the secret to how street magicians bite a quarter in half. And then, the magician walks through the spinning blades of a giant industrial turbofan. We'll expose how he does it. When Magic's Biggest Secrets Finally Revealed returns.
The magician will now attempt to solve a mathematical problem with a little help from the spirit world. He begins by showing us two old-fashioned slates. Kids used to write on these in school. The original laptops. He takes one of the blank slates and uses a piece of chalk to write some numbers. 7, 5, and a plus sign. Not exactly high finance, but it is a kid's chalkboard. Maybe he wants to go easy on the spirits. He leaves the solution blank, then places the two slates face to face. And just so that the spirits will have something to write with, he tosses in a piece of chalk. I think magical spirits would have magical chalk, but this is his trick, not mine. He gives the slates a couple of shakes, and presto, there's the solution. 7 plus 5 equals 12. adding was never so spooky. How does the magician solve this magical math problem and get the spirits to give him the answer? The secret here lies within the two identical slates. First of all, they're not identical. One of the slates has been cleverly rigged with a secret panel that fits within the frame. This thin piece of slate already has the solution written on it. The magician writes the mathematical problem and solution on the back of this panel, then loads it into the frame so we can't see the numbers. When he puts the two slates together, this secret panel flips down into the other slate, revealing the solution. Without showing us the writing on the panel, he drops in the chalk just for theatrical effect. When he thinks we're convinced the spirits are done, he separates the slates, revealing his pre-written solution. The illusion is complete, and he never even summoned one spirit. The magician has a trick that is perfect for a first date, Valentine's Day, or any time you want to say I love you with flowers. All he needs are a beautiful girl in extremely tight pants, and of course, a rose. She just happens to have one on that old-fashioned cigarette tray. Gotta love a girl who doesn't smoke and brings her own flower. In Hollywood, she's a total catch. Well, the magician has the flower and the girl. Now, what does he have in mind? From the look on her face, you can tell that she hopes his intentions are honorable. But she knows the masked man all too well. She's a brave girl to let him approach from behind. Maybe his magical trances really work. What's this? He's plunged the rose straight through her back and out through her stomach. That's one way to touch a girl's heart. Though for this much grief, she'd probably prefer jewelry. Now that his hand is out, she appears to be quite relieved.
It's the show that magicians around the globe don't want you to see. The Masked Magician is back, out of hiding, daring to expose the world's most highly guarded secrets. You'll find out how they perform amazing appearances, death-defying escapes, baffling levitations, astounding vanishes, mind-blowing sleight of hand, and impossible illusions. No magician is too famous. No trick too big. No secret too sacred. The magician's code will be forever broken on magic's biggest secrets finally revealed. Masked Magician pulls back the curtain and exposes the secrets to crushing a beautiful woman with a steel plunger and making her vanish while suspended in midair, floating through a solid steel frame without wires, plus penetrating a plate glass window without shattering it to pieces. And much more, right now on Magic's Biggest Secrets Finally Revealed.
This corrugated metal enclosure will be the site of the magician's first illusion tonight. As we can see, the enclosure is completely empty and free from magical gimmicks. Inside is an empty steel frame. Before the magician is a steel panel. It's also empty, solid, and free from gimmicks. Attached are these thick straps. When straps are securely attached to something, you know they'll be securely strapping someone. And here's that special someone now, the magician's beautiful assistant. She steps up onto the panel so that we can get a better look at her latest outfit. It's a nice one. Next, she gets down onto the panel and prepares to recline. The magician calls in two male assistants to help him. Apparently, she's more than he can handle. The assistants strap the girl to the panel, just as I suspected. At least she's dressed for it. Remember, there are no camera tricks involved. The magician checks the strap and does some conjuring while he's at it. He calls in two more assistants, and the four men lift the panel and carry it into the metal enclosure. They position the panel within the empty steel frame and lock it in place. We can see how tightly the girl is strapped down. He doesn't want her to get away. Next, the assistants remove the metal braces so that we have a clear view of the girl within the metal enclosure. Watch. The magician gives us another look at the girl, and for this, I'm grateful. He conjures a cloud of smoke, a flash. She's gone. The girl and the steel panel have vanished in an instant. But where did she go? We'll just have to wait for the magician to show us how it's done. So how did the magician make his lovely assistant vanish while suspended in midair? It's not a camera trick. Here are the secrets. The first secret is in the sheet metal enclosure. Concealed in the back wall is a secret panel, behind which is a stagehand. We'll learn more about his role later. When the illusion begins, the girl is strapped to the metal panel. The magician and his assistants take great care to strap the girl securely so she can't go anywhere. Next, the panel is moved to the metal framework inside the enclosure. The framework contains several secrets. First off, the straps are real and it's critical to the girl's safety that they are securely fastened. They're padded for her comfort. But we'll get to that in a minute. When the assistants are securing the panel to the frame, what you don't notice is that they're releasing secret latches positioned in the corners of the frame. See? The latches flip out of the way. During the performance, the magician appears to conjure a puff of smoke and an explosion, and the girl is gone. But where did she go? Remember the stagehand hidden behind this secret panel? At the precise moment the explosion goes off, the stagehand opens his window and releases a lever on the frame that rotates the panel and the girl, concealing her from view. Now she is being supported by the padded straps, which protect her from falling to the floor below. The entire mechanism is designed so that this one tiny lever is all the stagehand needs to release in order to make the entire panel flip and conceal the girl. These safety spring locks are built into the frame to stop the panel after precisely one half rotation. So if the girl is strapped to the back of the solid panel, how can we see through the frame to the sheet metal wall? The secret here is that there is a mirror attached to the back side of the panel. When the panel rotates to conceal the girl, the side with the mirror is exposed and reflects the ceiling of the enclosure. The girl appears to have vanished, but we're actually seeing a reflection of the metal ceiling in the mirror. This is one trick that really is done with smoke and mirrors. Next, the masked magician will perform a trick that street magicians have used to mystify unsuspecting victims who end up believing in freakish powers. He'll use a deck of cards and an assistant as his random volunteer. He begins removing the cards a few at a time, telling the girl to say stop whenever she wants. And she does. The card that remains at the top of the stack is offered for her inspection. The magician turns his back so we can get a better look at the card and the girl. King of clubs. He asks her to hold the card tightly to her chest. Lucky card. Then he shows her an ordinary lighter. That's a real flame. So remember, don't try this at home. Ouch! That's what happens when you play with fire. See? A blister. Painful. There it is, as if we needed a better look. Next, he tells the girl to concentrate on her card, promising to reveal it with his freaky powers. Looks like she wants him to prove it. Again, he takes the lighter and pinches the flame. Ouch! I told him it was hot. But what's this? Burned into his flesh are a K and a club for the King of Clubs. Freaky, isn't it? But I bet he's burning to tell us the secret. So, how did the magician reveal that he knew the chosen card by branding the image in his flesh? Here are the secrets. Let's start with the cards. The magician knew which card the girl would choose all along, because before the trick began, he marked the location of the King of Clubs with his little finger. He removes a few cards, and when the girl tells him to stop, he removes one final stack. The card on top of the remaining pile is the one he offers to the girl. This is how he makes sure she chooses the king. The magician knows which card she'll choose, but how does he brand the symbols into his skin? The secret here is concealed within the lighter. Embossed into the sides of the lighter are stencils representing three values on one side and three suits on the other. The small circle on the bottom is the stencil the magician uses to convince us that he's caused a blister with the lighter. He turns his back as the volunteer shows her card, and at the same time he's gripping the bottom of the lighter tightly. The circle leaves a temporary impression on his thumb that looks like a blister. He pretends to burn his thumb and shows us the phony blister to prove it. Next, he tells the girl to think of her card and promises her he can guess what it is. He's really just stalling as he squeezes his thumb and forefinger against the stencils for the club and the king. This tight pressure will leave the appropriate markings in his flesh. When he pretends to burn himself the second time, he can reveal the impressions which have been secretly left by the stencils. And now, you know the secrets. For his next illusion, the magician will employ this curious-looking device that has a long plunger on one end. Resting on a thin table, this large box is shown to be completely empty. Both the front and back sides are open, so we can see everything. The magician calls in one of his beautiful assistants. Looking at her costume, we can almost see everything. He wants us to take a good look at the girl, because she's about to get inside that box. A perfect fit, just like her costume. The magician calls in his other assistants and the fun begins. They draw shades in the back and the front of the box and secure them to the face of the plunger. The line drawing on the front is a fair depiction of the girl inside with a little artistic license here and there. We get the idea. He hands the girl a red silk handkerchief as a lovely parting gift. Whenever a girl gets into a magical box, we can assume something is about to happen to her. As she continues to wave bye-bye, the magician backs up to the end of the plunger. Without warning, he pushes the plunger forward, presumably crushing everything in its path. But the girl is still waving. There's barely enough room for her inside. She pulls the handkerchief into the box, and the magician pushes the plunger all the way forward, completely crushing the girl. As we can see, there is nothing left inside the box except for the long plunger. The girl has been completely flattened. Her lovely co-workers don't seem to mind. Catty. The magician withdraws the plunger, and we can see that nothing untoward has happened to the line drawing of the girl. But will her amazing lines fare so well? The assistants rotate the box so we can see that the shade in back has also been restored to its original condition. and now to get a look inside. He gives a magical wave and commands one of the assistants to open the shade. There's the girl, and she's not the least bit flattened. Another incredible illusion that demands a credible explanation. So how did the magician crush his assistant flat as a pancake? As usual, the secrets are inside the box. The first secret lies deep within the base. It's actually much deeper than it appears. Closer inspection reveals a trap door in the false bottom and a secret compartment below that is nearly a foot deep. See? Lots of room to store a girl who is physically fit. The left side of the box isn't solid. It's made of spandex, concealing another hiding place. When the illusion begins, the girl climbs into the box and the shade is drawn. But with the shade open, we can see how she quickly opens the trap door and slides her legs into the compartment in the base. She presses her back against the spandex, which allows her torso to hide in the side. Snug as a bug. The magician gives her a handkerchief to wave through a hole in the top of the box. This creates the illusion that she is still relaxing in the center of the box. But without the shade, we can see that she is already in her hiding spot by the time the handkerchief is placed into her grip. She pulls it down seconds before the magician drives the plunger all the way into the box, making it appear that she has been completely crushed. Without the shade, we can see that the plunger can slide all the way in without harming her, even though it is pressing tightly against her. The secret here is that the face of the plunger is also made of spandex. When it presses against her, it's like she's being crushed between two soft pillows. Nice. All that's left to complete the illusion is to reverse the action. The plunger is withdrawn, and the girl immediately climbs back out of the base. She replaces the false bottom and gets ready for the moment of her big reveal. And that's how to put a crush on a girl without breaking her heart. Now for a trick that involves almost no preparation or special props. All you need is a volunteer, a pad of sticky notes, and a pen. The magician tells his volunteer to think of an object to sketch on the pad. He tells her that he'll be able to duplicate the drawing magically, no matter what she chooses. He hands her the pen and pad and tells her to draw. He even turns around so he can't see and places his hands behind his back. Even though this is his assistant, she's not in on the trick, so this trick will work with any random volunteer. Look at that, a heart, how sweet. She folds the drawing as instructed and places it in the magician's hand. Now, he convinces her that his magical powers of ESP are about to go to work and tells her to concentrate on her drawing. He turns around and attempts to read her mind. Oh, if only he could. He rubs the sticky note and turns around when he thinks he has the answer. He hands her back the note, still folded, and takes the pad and pen. He'll now attempt to draw the same object she's drawn just by reading her mind. Let's see how good he really is. He asks her to open her drawing and she reveals the heart. He then turns the pad around to show what he's drawn. How about that? A perfect match. So, did the masked magician really read the innocent girl's mind? Of course not. There's a secret. He asks the girl to draw a picture on the pad of sticky notes. The pad is one of the secrets to this trick. The sticky backing is essential. When the magician turns his back, the volunteer places her folded sketch into his hand. What you didn't see was a blank folded sticky note hidden in his other hand. When the magician turns around to tell the volunteer to concentrate on the object she drew, he sticks her drawing to the column behind him. He turns around to face the column, being careful to hide the sticky note from her view. In his hands, he holds the folded blank note, which the volunteer will assume is her drawing. While she's busy concentrating on her object, he's sneaking a look at her sketch. Once he's memorized it, he turns around and secretly removes the note. He folds it back up and exchanges it for the pad and pen. He duplicates the object he saw in her sketch and then reveals it to her. Whether it's a simple heart or a number or letter, it's easy to recreate when you know the secret. For his next illusion tonight, the magician will demonstrate the magical powers of his latest invention, this high-tech machine that turns antimatter into matter. Not that it matters. Just keep an eye on what he can do with it. On the front of the machine is a control panel. The flashing lights indicate that the materialization process is ready to begin. He sets a couple of switches to delay the experiment and offers us an exclusive look inside. It's empty, except for a few more panels of lights, which indicate the machine is now at full power. We're ready to begin. Now for the master switch. A flash of light, a surge of electricity, and a skeleton appears inside the machine. Somewhere, a biology class is missing its mascot. This illusion defies all the laws of science. He flips the switch again, and now the skeleton has taken the shape of the female form. I'd say it was impossible if I hadn't seen it with my own eyes. The magician makes an adjustment and throws the switch one more time. Keep your eye on the humanoid. It's now transformed into a beautiful woman. She's alive! The heck with science. I love this trick. But is she real? An explosion, and the gorgeous girl emerges from the machine, fully formed and fully functional. Nice job, Masked Man. Now make one more for me. So, how did the masked magician create a living doll in his futuristic machine? Here are the secrets. When the illusion begins, the magician shows us the machine, which is basically a large box dressed up with flashing lights and phony switches. These lights and switches are just Hollywood props. They don't do anything other than blink and look really cool. The real secrets are hidden inside the box. When we look through the opening, it appears that we can see all the way to the end of a long hallway. What we don't know is that the hallway contains a large sheet of glass that is on a 45-degree angle to the front of the box. When light shines on the space behind the glass, we see through it to the empty hallway. But how does the cheap skeleton magically appear? Hidden just to the right of the glass is a secret compartment. When the light shines into the compartment, whatever is inside is reflected onto the glass. In this case, the girl. There is another secret room at the end of this hallway. Inside are another girl and the plastic skeleton. When the hallway goes dark and the outside lights flash, this girl wheels the skeleton out of hiding and behind the sheet of glass. Next, the lights come up in the hallway, exactly as the lights in the duplicate empty compartment are going down. Now the skeleton becomes visible through the glass and the reflection of the empty hallway goes away. Next, we see the skeleton morph into a humanoid. Here's how. When the lights in the empty compartment are dimmed, a third girl places a mannequin inside and positions it precisely in the right spot. When the lights in the skeleton's hallway fade simultaneously with the lights in the mannequin's compartment, the reflection on the glass makes it look like the scary skeleton is transforming into the scary humanoid. It's really just the glass acting as a mirror. Now that the end of the hallway is dark, the skeleton is removed, and the gorgeous blonde steps into its place. When the magician pretends to activate the machine again, the lights outside flash and the lights inside the compartment go down as the lights in the hall go up, making it appear that the humanoid is turning into the lovely lady. That's really her at the end of the hall, standing behind the glass. But how does she get from behind the glass to the opening of the machine? The secret here is that the glass is hinged along one side. When the magician cues the small explosion, the smoke obscures the hallway long enough for a hidden stagehand to pull a cable, which opens the glass and allows the girl to walk straight out of the machine. What a walk. This trick is a complex choreography of lights, smoke, and mirrors. And now you know how it's done. Next, the magician will astound us with some sleight of hand. But wait, his shoelace is untied. Not a good look for such a sharp-dressed man, and not very safe. Wouldn't want him to trip and break his mask. He gives his shoe a shake, then a few more for good measure. He's either got ants in his pants or is inventing a new dance move. Or maybe he's using some magic. Let's watch. How about that? His shoelace has miraculously knotted itself. I'm fit to be tied. So, how did the magician make his shoelace tie itself by magic? Here are the secrets. First off, his shoelace is really tied the whole time. The next secret is in this retractable key ring. A duplicate untied shoelace is attached to the end of the string where the keys would normally be fastened. The magician takes the other end and secretly clips it to his belt. The string, seen here, runs inside his pant leg so that the untied lace sticks out while the tied lace is concealed by his pants. When the magician shakes his foot to make it look like he is tying the lace magically, all he's really doing is allowing the key ring to retract, pulling the untied lace up into his pants. See it go? Here it is again in slow motion. He presses the release and the lace shoots up inside his pants. Not so tricky when you know the secrets. This large steel frame will play a featured role in the magician's next mind-blowing illusion. So will his assistants. Here he is now, coming in from the mysterious fog. And here come the girls. And there goes the magician, floating straight up off the floor. The assistants return with the solid steel frame and pass it completely around the magician, proving that he's not supported from above, below, or anywhere. He's simply floating in midair. Let's see that again. Here's the frame, and there it goes, proving once and for all that it's not done with wires. Yet the magician continues to rise. And now he commands himself to lower, just in time to meet the ladies. How very smooth. So how did the magician make himself levitate and prove that there are no wires by having the steel frame passed around him from every direction? Here are the secrets. The first secret is in the wall of corrugated metal. Hidden within the seemingly random patchwork of metal sheets is a flexible rubber panel with a slit down the middle. Behind the wall is a solid steel arm that's attached to this hefty forklift. While the beautiful assistants enter and distract our attention, the forklift operator is driving forward, pushing the arm through the slit panel that's directly behind the magician. There it goes. Attached to the front of the arm is a plate containing a powerful electromagnet. The next secret is this harness that is concealed beneath the magician's costume. On the back is another heavy-duty metal plate that rests over the small of his back. When the mechanical arm comes in behind the magician, the forklift operator flips this switch, causing the electromagnet to securely grab onto the plate. When the magician appears to be magically rising off of the floor, he's really getting a lift from the forklift operator. But if he's attached to the metal arm, how do the assistants pass the large solid frame around him? It certainly appears that he's not being supported from any direction. The secret here is in the frame. It is solid metal, except for this small section on one side that's foam rubber, painted to look like metal. The foam bends and snaps back into place once the arm has passed through. When the first two girls move the frame toward the magician, they slow down slightly to hand it off to the other girls. Without the magician in place, we see that slowing the movement allows them to make sure the arm clears the foam rubber section. See it clear, then snap back. Next, when the assistants push the frame around the magician to prove there's nothing on either side of him, they're really just pushing it from the front to the back wall, completely avoiding the support. From this angle, we can see that there is plenty of room on either side of the support arm. Next, the forklift operator gently lowers the magician back to the floor, and the illusion is complete. Floating with no strings attached is easy when you know the secret. Next, the magician has a classic trick using this red silk handkerchief. Note that there's nothing in his hand. The magician takes the handkerchief and, if you'll pardon the expression, stuffs it into the top of his closed fist. Now watch. When he pulls the red handkerchief out of the bottom, it's yellow. He continues to stuff the red handkerchief into his fist, and out comes more yellow. Now for the rest of it. It's completely changed color and his hand is empty. Let's see that again. He stuffs the yellow handkerchief into his empty hand, just as before. This time when he pulls it out, it's red. See? Red. Yellow. Yellow goes in, red comes out. All the way out, and his hand is empty. The perfect trick. Okay, so how did the magician make the silk handkerchief change colors just by passing it through his empty hand? Here are the secrets. When the trick begins, the magician shows us an ordinary red handkerchief. What we don't see is this little flesh-colored tube that's concealed in his other hand and contains the yellow handkerchief and nothing else. But how does he make the red go in and the yellow come out? Before the trick began, the magician stuffed the yellow handkerchief into the tube. Then he inserts the middle finger of his right hand into the tube in order to conceal it in his palm. The tube is hidden in his closed right fist as he shows us the red handkerchief. He passes the red handkerchief through his empty left hand a few times to show it empty, then secretly transfers the tube from his right to his left. It appears that he's stuffing the red handkerchief into his left hand, but it's really going into the tube. See? The red goes into the top half, pushing the yellow out of the bottom. This creates the illusion that the handkerchief is changing color. Here we can see that he's simply pulling the yellow out of the tube as the red goes in. Ah, but how does he show us that his hand is empty? When he finishes stuffing the red handkerchief into his left fist, he secretly inserts his finger into the tube again and conceals it in his right hand. Once he removes the yellow, his left hand is empty for all to see. Now you know the secret to one of magic's classic tricks. The magician will use this empty office in the abandoned warehouse to duplicate an illusion made popular on TV by street magicians. He examines the glass in the office window. It's solid. No chips, breaks, cracks, or imperfections of any kind. In fact, it's the cleanest thing in this dusty joint. Next, he finds a discarded sheet of paper and calls in his lovely assistants to lend a hand. As always, he makes sure we get a good look at the girls. Next, he tells them what he wants them to do with the paper sheet. He places it in front of the window and indicates the exact spot where they should hold it. Meanwhile, the magician prepares for his big moment. He steps into the office and closes the door. While the girls work their magic outside the window, the magician will work his magic on the inside. See what I mean? Let's hope he's got more planned than this mime routine. Satisfied that the glass is solid, he instructs the girls to raise the paper. The magician climbs up behind the paper so we can see him one last time behind the solid pane of glass. Now watch. Suddenly, a finger bursts through the paper sheet. This is either a very convincing illusion, or the magician is going to have to pay for a broken window. That's his hand, all right. We can see both of the girls' hands on the paper, so they're not part of the deception. He tears the paper, and now his foot emerges through the glass. Now his whole body. But that glass was one solid piece. It still is. Absolutely incredible. This is one illusion that begs for an explanation. We just saw the masked magician penetrate a solid glass window without breaking it, just like certain famous street magicians have done to the amazement of millions of TV viewers. So how did he do it? Here are the secrets. Before he walks through the glass, the magician walks into the office. What we don't see is that hidden behind the wall are two of his assistants ready to make the magic happen. The magician shows us the glass and proves that it's solid. At least, this part of it is. The window is actually much larger than it appears from the front. The glass has a solid section on top and a cutout section in the lower half that is hidden by the wall. Attached to the bottom of the glass are two handles. Finally, the glass is fitted into a concealed guide rail that runs from the top of the window down to the floor. Once the solid part of the glass is covered by the paper, the assistants hidden behind the wall use the handles to raise the entire pane so that the cutout is above the window frame. With the paper covering the window, we don't see the glass moving or the large hole that is rising into place. Here it is from behind, without the paper covering the glass. But if the glass moves, why doesn't the open sticker on the upper left corner of the window move? Here's the secret. From the front, it looks like a sticker on the glass, From the back, we see that it's a solid sign, cleverly attached to the window frame and not the glass. It stays put as the glass moves in front of it. This simple sign adds authenticity and makes the illusion more convincing. With the cutout raised behind the paper, the magician carefully punctures a hole with his finger. At this point, a larger hole would reveal the cutout in the glass and give away the trick. To ensure the hole doesn't open too wide, the magician uses a sharp screw to pierce the paper. How's that for high tech? He saws the paper with the screw and slides his body through the opening, careful not to expose the cutout behind him. Here it is from inside the room. The paper is torn and the magician forces his way through the cutout in the window. The second he is through, the hidden assistants quickly slide the glass back into place. The paper is removed, and the solid glass is revealed. Nice job, girls. You made him look good again. And now you know his secret.
Next time, the masked magician returns to reveal more of magic's biggest secrets.